The story you're about to see is part of what has become known as America's industrial heritage. To understand our industrial heritage, we need to focus on a 9-county region and the significance those counties had in the development of our steel industry. This program focuses on the Cambria Iron Works and its contributions to the development and growth of America's iron and steel industry. Squatters first came to this area shortly after 1746. On July 6, 1754, a treaty was negotiated by order of King George II. Pioneer settlers came by way of boat on the Juniata or by foot on the Katanning Trail over Pennsylvania Road. Attacks by the Indians and French caused the area to be sparsely settled until 1776. Agriculture was the prime occupation, but soon iron products became important. Numerous iron furnaces were built throughout Blair and Cambria counties due to plentiful deposits of iron ore. The first such furnace was built in Mount Etna in 1809. Etna soon became one of the largest iron producers in the country. 18 furnaces would soon follow the Etna furnace in Blair and Cambria counties. The Pennsylvania Mainline Canal and the Allegheny Portage Railroad provided transportation previously unheard of and open trade prior to this. The trip from Philadelphia to Pittsburgh took 21 days. Now, the trip only took 4.5 days. In 1854, the Horseshoe Curve was completed, and the Pennsylvania Railroad, based in Altoona, became one of the most important rail systems in the westward expansion of the United States. Founded in November of 1800 by Joseph Yonge, Johnstown was affected by the region's growth, particularly the canal system. Johnstown was at the terminus of the western division of the mainline canal. The PRR built their railroad through Johnstown, providing an even better transportation system. Plentiful iron resources, a need for rail, and men with a vision were the foundation which eventually made Johnstown the home of the Cambria Iron Works, one of the most significant industrial complexes in the nation. Johnstown changed dramatically with the founding of the Cambria Iron Works. The city proper was soon surrounded by boroughs, which incorporated and contained numerous businesses owned and operated by the company. Johnstown's population switched its dependence on the canal to the railroad and the business it attracted. In 1773, 24-year-old George Shyrock King, a merchant of Mercersburg in Franklin County, arrived in Johnstown to pursue business opportunities. He opened a store on the northeast corner of Franklin and Main Streets, and for several years conducted a mercantile business. In 1840, he sold the business to John and William Shyrock with the intent of going to Pittsburgh to open a business. However, the panic of 1837 brought hardship, misery, and business stagnation, putting many people out of work, including King. Seeing the plentiful iron resources as a possible way to change the economic situations of the area, King began to search for a deposit of ore large enough to warrant the building of a furnace. Sometime between 1839 and 1840, he found such a deposit and built his furnace. After its completion, he was faced with limited cash flow, so King traded iron for merchandise to pay his employees. King, David Stewart, and John and William Shyrock gave the name Cambria to the furnace they built, about 3 miles from Johnstown on Laurel Run. Using charcoal for fuel, the first iron was produced in 1841. In 1842, Cambria furnace was completed, becoming the first iron furnace in the country. In late 1843, Dr. Peter Schoenberger and King purchased the Shyrock's interests and became equal owners of the Cambria furnace. They continued to ship pig iron to Pittsburgh in exchange for dry goods. The tariff of 1842 afforded protection for new businesses. Dr. Schoenberger and King responded by building two furnaces, Mill Creek and Benz Creek, situated about 4 miles from Johnstown in the opposite direction from the Cambria furnace. The tariff of 1846 proved damaging to much of the iron manufacturing done in America. David Stewart, owner of Blacklick Furnace in Indiana County, was affected and offered to sell his furnace to King and Schoenberger. They accepted, and the pair now owned four furnaces. Once the pig iron industry in Cambria County was established, George S. King recognized the potential of manufacturing iron rails. The Pennsylvania Railroad was completed to Pittsburgh in 1852, and King knew a market lay waiting. There were no rail mills in Pittsburgh at the time, and the closest one to Johnstown was at Brady's Bend in Armstrong County. In 1852, King went to New York and Boston to attract capital for building a rolling mill in Johnstown. King attempted to contact Simeon Draper, a broker in New York City, but was unable to meet with him. Since he found no help in New York, he headed to Boston, where he met with broker John Hartshorn. They struck a deal which would establish stock in the four furnaces and other assets to give King and Schoenberger the needed capital. At the end of 6 months, the Boston parties failed in their efforts to raise money, and the Johnstowners once more moved their efforts to New York. They tried again to contact Simeon Draper. This time, Draper subscribed to stock and couched for other subscribers. The company was organized with Draper treasurer, George Hodges secretary, and King as general manager. Organized in August 21st, 1852, certified August the 26th, 1852, and approved August 29th, 1852, the Cambria Iron Company was now ready for business. The capital stock was $1 million, with share costing $12.50 each. The company's properties were scattered over Cambria, Indiana, Somerset, and Westmoreland counties, and consisted of 14,000 acres of coal, iron ore, and timberlands. Strategically located adjacent to the Pennsylvania State Canal and the Pennsylvania Railroad. Within the year, construction began on a site purchased from Peter Levergood for $3,000 at about the same time they received an order for rails. Just after construction of the furnaces and the rolling mill, a trust agent for the Ohio and Toledo Railroad arrived in New York with a proposition to purchase rails to finish the line. He had no money, but offered to exchange bonds of the railroad company worth $200,000 for railroad rails. Simeon Draper agreed and promised to deliver the rails at $85 per ton. This agreement was made before the mill was even completed. The bonds were sold, and the fledgling Cambria Iron Company got the order for rails at $55 per ton, even though their market value was $80. The order was large, and the company was so eager to start business that the rails were furnished at the reduced price. Plant construction started in February of 1853, and by mid-December, many of the necessary structures for operations were in place. A blacksmith shop and six forge fires, as well as a pattern shop, with all the tools required for making all the company work needs. The rolling mill was making iron by February and could turn out 120 tons of rails every 24 hours. Not only were shops for the businesses built, but so was housing for the workers. Tenements for 40 families were completed by December of 1853, and others were still under construction. The four furnaces were built on the Johnstown Flats, 1/2 mile north of the railroad station and north of the Cambria Rolling Mill. Numbers 1 and 2 were built in 1854, number 3 in 1856, and number 4 started in 1857, but was not immediately completed. One engine furnished blast for all three furnaces. Before the workers were finished, the Cambria Iron Company suffered financial setbacks due to a drop in price for iron and rail. Simeon Draper failed, and the company was unable to keep operating. Business was suspended in 1854. It was at this time John Fritz, the superintendent of the rail mill, arrived in Johnstown to oversee the mill's operation.
The next morning, while waiting for breakfast, I went out to see how the town looked in daytime. And I can truly say that it was one of the most unattractive places I had ever been in. The streets were of clay, or rather a dark loam, an organic matter. The sidewalks, with a few exceptions, were of boards or plank, and in a great part of the town were the same material as the streets. Cows, hogs, and dogs all ran at large. The dogs would get after the pigs, they would squeal, the cows would bawl, and the dogs would bark and fight. I should have been amused if I had not been here to stay. When at last we got to work and rolled a few rails, the edges of their flanges looked like saw teeth. and the head was rough and full of small holes, and everybody about the mill, from the owners to the water boy, was disgusted and sick. This was especially true of the concerning the heaters and the men about the rolls, for they were paid by the ton of finished rail. And it was the general conclusion that something would have to be done, and right quickly too. There were three charcoal blast furnaces that belonged to the company, one of which happened to be in blast at the time. So we got some charcoal pig and puddled it and rolled it into the covers for the bottoms of the rail, the common iron being above them. These piles were rolled so as to put the charcoal iron on the edges of the flanges. This worked pretty well as far as the flanges went, but it did not cure the trouble with the heads. So we had to roll other covers for the tops of the piles and to make the heads of the rails good. And with hot and cold patching and a liberal use of putty, we managed to get some rails that passed muster. By continually experimenting in the piling of the iron and changing mixtures, we finally got some fairly good rails. But the engine and flywheel driving the train were of such a construction that it was not safe to run it over 50 revolutions per minute, which was too slow to make the rails out of the materials we were using. One of the most serious troubles was that the forward end of the pile would split open in the rolls so that when it came to enter it in the next pass, it refused to go in. And much time was lost in the bunting it in the buggy, consequently cooling the pile to such an extent that when the rolls did get hold of it, spindles, coupling boxes, and sometimes the rolls themselves would break, causing both expense and delay, which, in connection with the general depression in business, led to troubles that brought the enterprise to an end.
Just when Fritz's crew was able to get the mill into pretty good shape, financial problems arose concerning the prior Ohio and Toledo Rails agreement. Draper had pledged property of the company as security for fulfilling the rail contract. No money was to be had to make rails, and the United States Marshal and county sheriffs appeared to confiscate the property. It was a gloomy day for Cambria, Fritz remembered. The workmen were restless and threatened to quit work. He convinced the marshal and the Ohio-Toledo Railroad to allow him to roll rails for paying customers while producing the already promised rails. By doing this, Fritz was able to clear up the problem. But according to Fritz, at all times the works were on the verge of bankruptcy, and the lessee company, tired of being harassed not only by its own debts, but also by obligations of the parent company, Fritz had concluded the company must secure more capital. This was no easy matter, especially when the company was in such complicated financial positions. A search started for new capital in an effort to keep the company going. One of its creditors in Philadelphia was Martin Morrell and Company. Money was due this firm for goods. During a meeting of creditors, Daniel J. Morrell, a merchant, was appointed head of a committee to visit the works to recommend ways for creditors to realize their investments and to save this company from bankruptcy. Morrell recommended more capital be invested and for the company to resume business. Wealthy Philadelphian Matthew Newkirk was persuaded to invest in the company's stock and became company president. George King resigned as manager. This effort soon failed, and the company suspended operations again in 1855. Proper management was needed. It was Daniel Morrell who kept faith in the venture and formed a new company with new credit. On May 21st, 1855, Newkirk, president of the Cambria Iron Company, leased the property to the newly organized Wood Morrell and Company. The works were leased for a five-year period to end June 30th, 1860. Fritz received permission to build a totally new mill only after considerable time and difficulties, convincing Wood and Morrell and the company's manager and stockholders of the necessity of changes in his view.
To continue to run the mill as it was, I could see nothing ahead but a most disastrous failure. And having previously given the whole subject my most thoughtful consideration, even to its most minute detail, I was prepared to submit my plans and recommendations to the new company. Now, my proposal was to build a new train of rolls, three high, 20 inches in diameter. This would involve a new engine that would run with safety, 100 revolutions per minute, and it practically meant an entire new mill. As I look back to that eventful Sunday morning many long years ago, Sitting on a pile of discarded rails with evidence of failure on every side, Mr. Edward Townsend and myself quietly and seriously talking over the history of the past, the difficulties of the present, and the uncertainties of the future, I cannot but feel, in view of what has since come to pass, that it was not only a critical epoch in the history of the Cambria Company, but that as well the future well-being of my life was in balance. For as Mr. Townsend was about to leave, after a full discussion of the Cambria Iron Company's condition at that time, he turned to me and he said, "Fritz, go ahead and build the mill as you want it." I asked, "Do you say that officially?" To which he replied, "I will make it official." And he did so. And here I wish to say that to no other person so deservedly belongs the credit not only of the introduction of the three high roll train, but also of the wonderful prosperity that came to the Cambria Company, as it does to Mr. Edward Y. Townsend, then its vice president.
The old mill was stopped in July of 1857 and was torn out after the 4th of July. The rail department was completely remodeled. It was an extremely anxious time for Fritz.
About 10 o'clock in the morning, the first pile was drawn, and it went through the rails without the least hitch of any kind, making a perfect rail. You can judge what my feelings were as I looked upon that perfect and first rail ever made on a three-high mill. And you may, in part, know how grateful I felt toward the faithful and anxious men who were about me and who stood by me during all my trials and difficulties, among whom were Alexander Hamilton, the superintendent of the mill, Thomas Lapsley, who had in charge of the rail department, William Cannon, and my brother George.
In 1860, the lease was extended for two more years. In December 1861, the company was again reorganized due to the death of several partners. In January 1862, the stockholders of the company decided to reclaim all its property and operate it. Bonds came due, and the company could not redeem them. Wood, Morrell & Company bought all outstanding stock and paid King and Schoenberger for their old interests, thus ending the bonded indebtedness. In 1862, the company then reorganized with Wood as president and Edward Townsend as vice president. The lease was abandoned and the property was conveyed by deed in September 1862, keeping its original name, Cambria Iron Company. After Wood, Morrell & Company began leasing the Cambria Iron Company, their financial position improved. The works continued to grow, and from 1855 on, the company produced 10% of all rails rolled in America. In 1876, they rolled the largest tonnage of rails ever made in this country by one mill in a single year. By 1878, the works extended over 60 acres of land. The rolling mill alone covered 7 acres. Cambria Iron and Steel Works, Bessemer Process Blow, was in 1871. John Fritz spoke of the early difficulties and dangers which bore witness to both speculation and fear which accompanied each conversion.
In witnessing the beautiful and interesting but simple process of blowing a heat of metal and the regularity with which it is done at this time and the quantity turned out, it is impossible for one wholly unacquainted with its early history to even in a measure realize the fear and anxiety of those who were responsible for the result. When a charge of metal was poured into the vessel, anxiety commenced. And as the heat increased, anxiety increased in a corresponding ratio until both became intense. It was when the heat was greatest that accidents were most likely to happen. Altogether, the difficulties we encountered were enough to appall the bravest hearts. My brother George once said, when at Cambria, that he did not believe that there was a man who ever went into the Bessemer business and was responsible for the result who did not at times wish he had never gone into it. And so far, as my experience goes, I can fully verify it. And further, I think that if it had not been for the interesting and exciting character of the business, that few men would have been willing to endure the trouble and anxiety and to endure the physical labor and danger to which he and the workmen were constantly exposed, long enough to have placed the business on a commercial basis.
By mid-1870, the Cambria Iron Company had become the largest iron and steel works in the country. From just a few buildings in the lower works, the company grew to include Gautier Works and collateral businesses and spread for miles along the Little Conemaugh River. The quality of its iron and then steel secured the company's fame and fortune. Josiah H. Gautier moved his steel products company to Johnstown in 1878 from Jersey City to be near the sources of raw materials and tie into Western markets. The plant was built on the south bank of the Little Conemaugh River on what was called the Island. For 3 years, Gautier was a distinct subsidiary of Cambria Iron Company and was a limited partner. In July of 1881, the partnership was dissolved, and after December 1881, the Gautier Works became a department of the Cambria Iron Company. The Gautier department produced the famous Cambria Link barbed wire, rod, shafting, springs, plowshares, rake and borrow teeth, and agricultural steel. The entire Gautier department was destroyed in the May 31st, 1889 Johnstown flood. The only remnants were foundations and portions of engines and roll trains. The Cambria Iron Company leased a mill in Cumberland, Maryland until the Gautier mills were replaced. Company-owned land now extended throughout seven counties and totaled 46,403 acres, of which 41,000 acres contained iron and coal, or both. Mining operations occurred in four of these counties, Cambria, Blair, Huntington, and Bedford, while smelting took place in Cambria and Blair counties. Railway lines crisscrossed company property. Over 56 miles of standard and narrow gauge railroad, with 22 miles of this line underground. 13 locomotives hauled coal and ores from the mines to the blast furnace and mills. The Pennsylvania Railroad then carried the finished products to the east, west, and northwest markets, while southwest markets were reached by slack water navigation of the Ohio River out of Pittsburgh. Johnstown's fledgling iron and steel industry at Cambria went through several stages of change, which paralleled and at times even preceded that of industry as a whole. The expansion of the railroad changed the industry. From 1855 to 1870, the refining and smelting processes were integrated to satisfy the appetite of the new market for rails. Railroads insisted on high volume, prompt deliveries, and older refineries were not capable of meeting the need. Technical problems had to be solved, including building a rolling mill, which could produce a high volume of rails. The three-high structure rail train became the industry standard. By 1865, John Fritz's invention was used in one-third of all the country's rail mills. By 1880, the three-high rolls were used exclusively. Cambria was at the forefront of this change. The need to operate the rolling mills continuously meant the greater control over raw resources was required. Backward integration was the result. As a rolling mill could devour the output of several blast furnaces, the substitution of coal for wood as furnace fuel moved the furnaces away from the forests and towards the coal fields. The development of the puddling process, which superseded hammering to reduce the carbon in metal, was another technological change. All of these developments led to the integration of the blast furnace and rolling mill. It was at this time that the Cambria Iron Company was established, with the raw resources, smelting and refining processes all on site. The next era of development in the industry involved the discovery of the Bessemer process. Here again, experiments at Cambria led to the technological changes which fed the spectacular growth in the industry mechanization. Increased scale and mass of operation, high costs, and organizational structure followed as Cambria entered the age of steel. As early as 1860, the Cambria Iron Company was one of four iron mills in America with more than 1,000 employees. By 1870, both Cambria and Bethlehem Steel were the only steel plants with more than 2,000 employees. By 1880, after the Bessemer steel process was in place and the Gautier Works were absorbed, Cambria was the largest iron and steel company in America. By 1900, Cambria was one of four plants to employ more than 8,000 workers, and only Jones and Laughlin and Homestead compared in size. The Cambria Iron Company was founded in response to a need for ending American dependence on foreign iron imports and for promoting the domestic production of iron rails to feed the expanding railroad system. The company faced difficult economic times in the first years of production, But through refinancing and belief in the company's potential, its owners and workers kept the iron rails rolling. The Cambria Iron Company did not retain its technological or production dominance, but it did remain a contributing force in the field as an independent steelmaker for many years, and a transfer of technology that led to an expanding note for the American steel industry. Everyone else borrowed this technology, and in the words of John Fritz,
the Cambria Works had the best set of men about them in the country. In proof of this, I can point with pride to the number of men that have gained prominent position in other works. The training they received at Cambria was such as to well qualify them to fill any position they might assume. The men would frequently say that all the passport they needed was to say they had labored in the Cambria Iron Works.
Steel in America has changed, and most of the changes have been for the good. The industry is smaller, but more efficient. Today, the products coming out of the American steel industry are as good as those produced anywhere in the world. Sprawling mills and smoke-belching stacks that were common sights in many parts of the nation over the years have gone. For the most part, today's steel plants are streamlined, efficient, and environmentally clean operations. Computers now control a wide range of manufacturing operations in a modern mill, and employees, for the most part, are higher qualified and more productive than ever before. There's a new awareness in today's steel industry, as the old conflicts between labor and management are being replaced by discussions and cooperation. Partnerships between blue-collar and white-collar workers are being formed in an industry once known for its sometimes violent strikes and labor disputes. Today's steel industry is radically different, and change has been the key. At the same time, there is no doubt that the steel industry will continue to change in the future. New attitudes are being formed. New technologies are being developed. New products are being researched, and the world market for steel is changing. And just as the industry has undergone change, so has Bethlehem's Johnstown plant, which more recently has become known as Bethlehem's Bar, Rod, and Wire Division. Steelmaking operations here are a far cry from a few short years ago and bear no resemblance at all to steelmaking here in the earlier part of this century. From the earliest day of steelmaking in this country, Johnstown and Johnstowners have shared in the development of the industry, providing the basis for America's Industrial Revolution and establishing this country as a world economic power. Many of this nation's great political leaders and industrial giants have had their beginning in the steel industry, and many have had close ties with the Johnstown region. Among these industry giants was William Kelly, whose Kelly Converter changed the entire future of steelmaking in America. It was the development of the Kelly Converter that established Johnstown as a leading steel center in the late 1800s. And years of evolution since then led first to the installation of open hearth furnaces here, and eventually to today's modern and highly efficient electric furnaces. The process of change, both in the American steel industry and here in Johnstown, have been difficult at times. But with each change has come more improvements designed to make operations here more efficient. Johnstown has been and remains today a steel town. More residents here have ties with one way or another to the local plant. Sons and daughters, grandparents, great-grandparents, and beyond have worked in the Bethlehem Steel's local plant. Johnstowners take a great pride in their steel heritage. and the current efforts to recognize Johnstown's significant industrial history are a tribute to many men and women who have worked in the mills, mines, and the railroads of this region over the years. Johnstown is proud of its heritage and its contribution to the nation's current industrial strength, even after having suffered through three major floods. Johnstown and its steel mills have managed to survive. And it's that same kind of determination that will help Johnstown to grow and survive in the future.
The procedure for establishing Cambria Iron Works as a national landmark are well underway. Western Pennsylvania is fortunate to have such a significant resource that contributed to America's industrial heritage. It is important that people from all over the nation have an opportunity to see what remains of Cambria and hear its stories.